Brian Lennon's father, John, was born in Liverpool, England. The Charlie Chaplin satirical film The Great Dictator premiered in New York City. And Superman was shot by a pharmacist. Accidentally. It all happens in the next issue of Action Comics.
Greetings, super friends, and welcome to another fantastic episode of Reaction Comics, where today we're here to discuss Action Comics number 29 from October 1940. And yes, it is October 2021. Yes, this comic book is 81 years old. Can you believe? Just think about that. I know all the comics we've been doing are that old. If not older. Well, I guess all of them are technically older because they came out first. But when you really think about how old these books are, how old these stories are, it's, I don't know what it is, but it makes you think. It makes you think, So as I like to do in every issue, I'd like to kind of go over the cover, which, again, I don't think has anything to do with this issue. And I know I had this theory where the cover would have to do with the next issue, but I don't think that's the case. Wasn't the last time a guy was throwing a guy off a building? And I don't think that's happening here. I don't think that happened in this story. So I'm going to take that theory and kind of throw it out the window. So what we have here, we have Superman. He's leaping away from a green automobile. He has a woman. I always want to say it's Lois because, again, they're not the greatest at drawing women. And when you see a brunette, you just assume it's Lois. I don't know if that's the case. She's in a yellow dress. She's got a yellow, like a gag around her mouth. The people who took her were nice to color coordinate. And Superman is kind of leaping away with her. She looks out of it. Like her eyes look closed. And he's leaping away from this green car, which seemed to have very dapper dressed mobsters in it. One guy's hat's falling off, and one guy's driving, and two other guys have guns. They're shooting, and apparently they're missing because, I mean, Superman's fine, but the woman, she would be torn to shreds by the bullet. And that doesn't seem to be the case, so I guess no harm, no foul. So why don't we get into the story? This is a first for me. This is the first time I've seen anything like this in Action Comic. The first page is a full page drawing. Like, this looks like it should be the cover. It is a great drawing because it's, again, full page, all kinds of action. And I mean, where what better place to have action such as this than in a pharmacy? Or I don't know if they were called pharmacies then or if they were just called drugstores or druggists. But it shows an angry mob of people outside. We're inside the drugstore, so Superman, because he smashed through the front door, he's kind of facing us with his arms in the air, and the pharmacist is behind the prescription counter, and he's shooting at Superman because, I mean, you've been to CVS, Walgreens. I mean, they're all packing. And the people outside are angry. I don't know if they're trying to get in. I don't know if they're trying to stop Superman. I don't know what's going on, but it's definitely a prescription. Like the counter says prescription department. And, this dude is definitely, firing his pistol at Superman, who at the very least, owes them a new glass front door. And we see a, text box and it says, "Aged, helpless people, the victims of a ghoulish plot, a secret fiend waxing wealthy through the spilling of their innocent blood. This is the setup which Clark Kent, meek Daily Planet reporter, investigate, and which Superman, champion of the helpless and oppressed, smashes. So it's almost like it's giving us a little preview, because there's no context to what we're looking at here. In the very next page, we're not at the pharmacy. I'll tell you that right now. We're at the are we at Clark's house? It says midday. Lois and Clark have a half day off from their chores at the Daily Planet. Apparently they're doing their chores. They got them done early, so they got their allowance and they're let to go home. Clark is on the phone calling Lois. He says, "Hello, Lois. Are any chance of me taking you for a spin this afternoon?" "Swell." So Clark does what he does best. He talks to himself. He gets in the car and he says, "She said to pick her up at 2:00. Can it be that Lois is finally breaking down and recognizing my charm at last?" Now at 2:00 sharp, Clark shows up at Lois's apartment, rings the doorbell. But funny, there doesn't seem to be anybody home. Yeah, he looks at his watch, heads outside, and says, she's probably been detained. I'll wait outside in the car. She ought to be here any minute. And then an hour passes. Clark Kent, you schlub. Lois finally appeared. Clark gets out of the car and says, Lois, hey, I've been waiting for you since 2:00. And she looks at Clark and says, "Clark, oh, I'd forgotten all about you." And then she seems to remember and says, "That's right. I was going for a drive with you." "Splendid. So can you take me down to 1819 Chestnut Street?" So now he's her Uber. So she gets in the car and Clark's like, "But that's in the slums and I was going to take you for a drive through the park. I refuse to do it." And the next panel actually says, but 15 minutes later, Clark and Lois pull up before 1819 Chestnut Street. And Clark says, what's the use? You always get your way, Clark. You are a pushover. My goodness gracious. She didn't even, like, she said, it was like a joke almost. I refuse to do it. And then the next panel, but I did it. Blue. So they get out of the car and Clark says, may I at least inquire who we're visiting? Lois says, a lovely crippled old lady. Every time they say crippled, I don't know, it just feels so out. It's so dated that it just makes me laugh. A lovely crippled old lady, Mrs. Dave. Her sister, who supported her, a Mrs. Bradford, died recently. And I'm afraid it means the poorhouse for Mrs. Davis. So they're heading to her house, apartment, whatever. Some dude comes out. He's got a nice little checkered suit on. Kind of looks like a haggard Ronald Reagan. What do you want? Who are you? I'm Lois Lane, friend of Mrs. Davis. And may I ask who you are? I'm Tom Bruce, neighbor of Mrs. Davis. If you want to see the old lady, go on in. Nobody's stopping you. I don't know why he's so rude. Lois looks over at Clark and says, nice-tempered gent, isn't he? Clark says, shh. Apparently Clark is, you know, again, he's the weak coward. That's the role he's playing. He doesn't want this guy to overhear them and possibly want to fight them. So they go in to see this old lady. What's her name again? Mrs. Davis. So there's Mrs. Davis, who they're going to visit. Mrs. Bradford, who's dead. And Tom Bruce, who's the neighbor, I guess. I don't know what he was there for. Or he didn't do anything. Maybe he was checking on them. I guess. I don't know. Lois Lane, how nice of you to come and see me. This old lady got like a little a shawl over her, and she's got a little kerchief like a nice pilgrim would wear. And Lois says, I've come to offer my condolences. Well, I guess it's nice that Lois is checking in with old ladies. And this other woman, who I really thought was a maid, but apparently that's not a... I thought she had a... an apron on, but I think that's just the way it was drawn. It's actually a pillow for Mrs. Davis. So this other woman's like, "Hurr." And I don't know what she's all harumphing about, but Lois is back to talking to Mrs. Davis. I'm so sorry you've been left in a precarious position, Mrs. Davis. And Mrs. Davis says, oh, but I haven't. I've collected some insurance money thanks to Mr. Fullerton. Another guy, Mr. Fullerton, a lot of names. Mr. Fullerton is an insurance man. He makes it possible for poor people to buy small insurance policies for very little premium payment. A fine man, Mr. Fullerton, a fine, great benefactor. And this other lady, she does not seem to be buying. She's like, benefactor. And I mean, she looks like a cross of the two first ladies at Night Court. Like that old, not the Where's the Beef lady. Yeah, the Where's the Beef lady, maybe the second lady. Kind of mix them together. And that's what this woman looked like. Benefactor. Bruh. That man's a slimy crook, I say, and I'm going to quit his insurance club before I go the way of the many others who died mysteriously. Wait, people are dying mysteriously? Uh-oh. And Clark says, that's quite a difference of opinion as to Mr. Fullerton's merit. And Mrs. Davis is like, no chance. She's like, I won't have you talking about that way about Mr. Fullerton, Miss Grady. Please leave this house. Miss Grady, Mrs. Grady, she's like, at once. But I'll wager Fullerton knows more about Lizzie Bradford's death than he lets on. I'll stop up at your office one of these days, Miss Lane, and I'll relate a story that will make the front pages. Okay, if I was this woman, I'd be like, you know what? Why don't we go now and talk about this? This seems pretty big. So Lois seems to ignore her completely and goes back to Mrs. Davis. I hear you haven't been feeling well, Mrs. Davis. What's the trouble? And Mrs. Davis is like, just some headaches, but when I took something to relieve them, they only got worse. And now Lois is like, speaking of headache, I think I have one coming on myself. Where can I find your aspirin? She says, in the medicine cabinet. And all of a sudden, this Tom Bruce guy is back. Like, out of nowhere, he sneaks his head in and goes, I'll get them for you. So now Clark is saying, can I help you, Lois? And she says, never mind, I'll get the aspirin myself. But he follows her into the bathroom, and as she takes the bottle of aspirin from the cabinet, Clark uses his x-ray vision, and he's like, good grief, those aren't aspirin tablets, they're slow-acting poison. I don't know how you can tell that by looking at them, but Clark notices right away, so he acts swiftly. And how does he do that? He pushes Lois. I mean, he pretends to fall against Lois. But he really kind of shoves her and goes, oops, pardon me. She says, you clumsy ox, you made me drop them. And Clark says, it's just as well. Look at these. They aren't aspirin. They're deadly poison. And Lois says, what? And again, Tom Bruce pops his head in, like, just out of nowhere and says, poison, did you say? And now we're back out to Mrs. Davis. She said, yes, my sister and I bought our medicines at Graham's drugstore, but... Clark says, Graham's drugstore, eh? Lois, excuse me, but we've got to leave in a hurry. So they're right outside Graham's drugstore, and Clark says, I think we're on the track of a first-rate story. Lois says, this is the store. So they go in, and they see Graham. I guess a young Patrick Stewart. He's got, you know, a little bit of that hair around the side, but he's bald on top. He says, yes, I'm the owner of this drugstore. Well, we'd like to get some aspirin, some Giddy's aspirin. And Clark says, the same brand that you sold Mrs. Bradford. And the druggist is like, Giddy's aspirin, I'm afraid we're out of it. And Clark says, well, I'm afraid you're letting yourself in for a lot of questioning. Mrs. Bradford's aspirin contained poison. And Graham's like, I don't know what you're trying to pull here, but get out of here before... He grabs Clark and starts to shove him out the door, and Clark's like, careful. Lois says, Clark, what are you doing letting him get away with that? Now they're outside, and Clark's like, but Lois, and you call yourself a reporter. Oh, if you had any ounce of courage in your body... Then Clark says, look, and a block away... They see a hit-skip driver speeding swiftly away from the scene of his crime. It's a green car, and they run over some old lady. Oh, wait a second. Who is this old lady? She is definitely... she dead? The next scene, it says... it shows Clark. As Clark and Lois rush to the scene, they find that the victim of the hit-skip car is none other than Mrs. Grady. She was the one at the house. Now... This is a quick acting ambulance. So they rush to the scene and the ambulance is already there. I mean, this woman's body is like still rolling down the street. Lois like, it's Mrs. Grady. She was going to tell me something about Fullerton. Perhaps her death isn't as accidental as it seems. Well, maybe Lois, you should have followed up with her quicker. Clark says she didn't have time to quit the Fullerton Insurance Club. Now, outside of Graham's drugstore, there seems to be excitement. Excitement stirs before Graham's drugstore as a mob violent is outside. And I don't know what they're saying. They're like, Graham killed Mrs. Bradford. Get him. The poisoner. So I guess the word got out that there was poison in the aspirin. That got out pretty quick. And Graham's inside saying, keep back. Keep back, I say. And they're outside with, you know, bats. And he definitely has a pistol in his hand. Oh, okay. Leading the mob is Tom Bruce, the next door neighbor who knew about the poison. He says, there's only one of them and hundreds of us. Rush him, I say. And they're like, Tom's right. So they start rushing into they're trying to rush into the drugstore, or at least they're about to. And Lois says, we've got to prevent a riot, Clark. Stop them somehow, some way. Clark says, I better go run and get the police. Lois says, you can run off and hide, but I'm going to try to stop them before it's too late. Now, Lois, I'm sorry. There's like 20 to 30 dudes out there. Why do you always put yourself in this dangerous, dangerous predicament? Clark says, Lois, come back. But moments later, in a secluded alley, Lois ran off. So Clark's like, all right, this is my chance. He says, little time to act. That mob's about to go wild. And Lois is in the thick of it, so he takes off his outfit. And of course, now he's Superman. So Lois goes up to that Tom Bruce dude and's like, stop inciting this crowd. He says, get away from me, you. Forward, everybody. Let's get Graham. And Graham's got his gun out. He's like, I warned you to keep back. As Graham's finger tightens on the trigger, over the mob's head whizzes a human lightning bolt. And he says outside, seconds to act. For some reason, he's saying that. He's flying leaping straight towards the drugstore. And the Man of Steel catapults into the drugstore just in time to receive the bullet meant for Lois upon his chest. So this dude was going to shoot Lois because she's at the front of the mob for some reason. And she says, it's Superman. And one of the guys says, my gosh. Superman yells, drop that gun. But the gun goes off and the pharmacist is like, what? The mob flees in panic at the sudden appearance of the blue clad figure. And the pharmacist is like, I didn't mean it. The gun went off accidentally. It seems to happen a lot in these comic books. And as Superman leaves the drugstore, Lois says, again, you saved me. And Superman looks at her and goes, it's getting to be a habit, eh? And then in the corner of the little panel, we see another gun pointed right at them. And we hear, all right, Superman, raise your hands. And we turn and we see that it is a police officer. And Superman says, well, look who's here. My old friend, Sergeant Casey. Sergeant Casey says, but this time you won't get away. Come along now. Pardon me, what did you say? Just what I mean. You won't get away this time. But of course, what is Superman best at? It's at evading police and resisting arrest. With a sudden bound, the Man of Steel, leaps past the amazed Casey and zooms up into the sky. Casey says, come back here, all. And we know what he'll do, but Superman says, sorry to leave you so suddenly, Sergeant, old boy. And he jumps away. Minutes later, he touches down into an alley. And it says, now to change back into Clark Kent. He really shouldn't say this out loud because, like, anyone could hear him. As Clark Kent, he hurries back to Lois. And Lois is like, I knew you'd show up once the danger was over with, as usual. Clark's like, I couldn't find a single policeman anywhere. Meanwhile, Sergeant Casey is holding onto Tom Bruce. And there's this fella there who, I mean, I don't know. He's got like a bowler hat. Jonathan Winters, maybe? I don't know. And he says, let him go, officer. Almost like W.C. Field, maybe like that. And the cop says, okay, I will. But not because you're the local ward politician, but because we don't want his kind cluttering up our jail. That's the last thing you want, is a criminal in your jail. I don't want any criminals in my jail. Why, I oughta? So, I don't know why, but they seem to really focus on this guy as being the local ward politician. So we jump back to Clark He's like, where to now? And Lois says, Fullerton's office. We know plenty about these deaths. I'll get him to talk. But now they're going to the insurance guy. So here's Fullerton's office. You needn't come with me if you're afraid. Lois is going, and she's not afraid of anything. And Clark's like, afraid? Who's afraid? I don't know why he's afraid. So they go into this office, and this dude is like, I don't know, Clark Gable. I was going to say a young Thurston Howell, but not even close. I would say more of a Clark Gable, but with the style of a young Thurston Howell. Maybe we'll say it. So now they're in this Fullerton's office, and he says, Daily Planet reporters, eh? What can I do for you? Lois says, just answer a few questions first. Did Mrs. Bradford carry any life insurance? Life insurance? Yes, a small policy. She was a member of the insurance club. Just one small policy? No other policies payable to anyone else? I resent your innuendos. Get out of here. And Clark's like, he wants us to leave. Lois says, I was going to anyway. So they head out, and as they leave Fullerton's office, Lois is thinking to herself, now if I can get rid of Clark, I can put my plan into execution. So long, Clark. I think I'll return to Mrs. Davis and ask her some more questions. And Clark says, that sparkle in Lois's eyes gave her away. So Lois leaves. Clark's talking to himself again. He's like, she's up to something. It's time I change to my Superman identity. And again, if you're standing nearby, now you know who Superman is. So Superman, Clark changes into Superman, jumps to the top of the Fullerton office's building and creeps down, looking down at Lois. A few minutes later, he sees her going back into the Fullerton offices. But, oh no, I'm sorry, she's going to the back of Fullerton's office. Why is she going to the back? Oh, because she's attempting to break in and enter. Lois is attempting to enter the back window of the insurance office building. She said, perhaps if I can get into his private office. And of course, the window's open, and as Lois enters the window, there's two people there. One guy looks like a real ruffian. And the first guy says, tie her to a chair. And the second guy says, okay, Tom. Bum, 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 Tom Bruce? Is he behind this? The neighbor? The Ronald Reagan guy? Maybe smoking a lot of cigarettes, well haggard. I don't know if he looks like Reagan. I'm not sure. But that's the first thing I thought of. The plot thickens. I wonder what Mr. Tom Bruce has to do with this. So Lois is tied to a chair now, gagged. And this Tom Bruce says, now that we've got the papers where we're after, let's go. He says, wait. The girl will be able to describe us. So he pulls out a pistol of his own. He says, we'll fix her so she can't talk. Die, you blasted snooper. But before she can pull the trigger, drop that gun, Superman flies into the room, smashes through the window, grabs these guys, and the Man of Steel's amazing strength terrorizes the two vicious hoodlums. Superman says to them, you dirty rats, I'll teach you to pick on a helpless goyle. I don't know why he has that accent all of a sudden. And the guy's like, help. And Tom Bruce is going, oh. Meanwhile, in the front of the office, Fullerton hears the noise. And he calls the cops. I mean, isn't he a criminal? So he calls the cops. He says, police, hurry. It sounds like there's a struggle in my private office. So Sergeant Casey and the police arrive just as Superman is freeing the captive Lois. Wait, how fast are the police? Clark bumps these two idiots on the head, unties Lois. That's what, 5-10 seconds? So the cops really have good response time at Metropolis. Stay where you are, all of you. Don't move. And they're pointing the guns at these two hoodlums. But they're definitely also talking to Superman. And Superman just looks at Lois, is like, that's our cue. He unties her. And in the twinkling of an eye, the Man of Steel streaks through the window with Lois in his arm. Up we go. He's jumping away, and Lois is like, how marvelous. Then he brings her to the Daily Planet roof, and all she can think is, Superman, come back. And he says, sorry, I've work to do. Now, later on, Bruce and his companion leave the police station on bail furnished by a bondsman. So they were able to make bail. And they said, we better tip off Martin. Martin? What's going on here? Unknown to them, the thugs are being trailed by Superman. They're heading to the home of Martin, the political boss. I'm like, who the hell's Martin? So, the guy before who I thought looked like a W.C. Fields, did they actually name him? No. They never said his name was Martin. So when they say Martin, what the hell? We don't even know what's going on. So now they're heading to Martin, the political boss, who was in one panel a while ago, telling the police officer to let go of Bruce. Now, in front of Martin's residence, come on in. The two guys are going in, and Martin says, how many times have I told you not to come here? And Bruce is like, this is important. We've come to tell you that Superman has barged us. Has barged. Okay? I guess that's one way of saying things. He says, Superman, did you say? Huh. Get going, boys. Take to cover and leave everything to me. And Bruce says, okay, boss. Meanwhile, back at Fullerton's office. Because this, I guess this insurance guy, I don't know what the hell's going on. Is he in on it? Is he not in on it? Lois says, I've come to tell you that I have full proof of your racket. She's thinking to herself, I hope this bluff works. Meanwhile, he's pointing a gun at her. He says, oh yeah? Yeah? Well, come with me. So Fullerton forces Lois into his car and drives her to Martin's house. I don't know why they're going to Martin's house. Maybe they all know they're going to Martin's house, and that's where they're all going to the man in charge of everything. So now Martin is there with the two thugs, and he's like, what does this interruption mean? Now Fullerton shows up with Lois, and he says, Martin, I want to see to it that this reporter is fully prosecuted by law. She's been making an intolerable nuisance of herself, accusing me of murdering my clients. Wait a second. So this dude is completely innocent, except now he kidnapped Lois to prove that he's innocent? Very confused. So now this Martin dude says, I can't be bothered. I'm leaving town right away. He says, you'll stay where you are. This is Fullerton now. After all, you furnished the financial backing of the insurance society. You're responsible for it. And this Martin guy says, okay, you're asking for it. Murder for insurance? Sure, the society did it. Only without your knowledge, Fullerton. I'm the one who cashed in the policies, and it's been fixed to appear that you were guilty, one Fullerton. So now Martin completely, for some reason, completely copped to everything and showed that Fullerton is, again, innocent of everything, except, of course, kidnapping Lois at gunpoint. And now Martin says, as a matter of fact, I even took out a policy on your life. And this is why. And he shoots him. And the guy goes, ow. And Lois says, you've killed him. And this Tom Bruce guy, grabbing Lois, and says, you're next, girl. Next, like literally the next panel, Superman just, instead of going through the door, instead of going anywhere, he smashes right through the wall of the house and says, let me in on this. This Martin guy says, oh. Lois says, it's Superman. And this Tom Bruce says, my gosh, I mean, there's so many friggin' names in this issue. This won't hurt much. Superman is saying to this guy, Martin, and he's like, no. And Tom Bruce says, don't touch us. Like a flash, Superman touches them upon a certain nerve, causing them to drop unconscious, almost like a Vulcan neck pinch. Just boom. They're both unconscious. With his bare hands, the Man of Steel rips open Martin's great safe. There'll be enough evidence in here to hang them. Superman's hoping for capital punishment and for both men to be executed. And Superman and Lois says, must you go? Here comes Sergeant Casey and his men. They'll take care of the criminals. So Superman leaves. Yay! Later on, back at the Daily Planet, Lois and Clark are there, and she's explaining to Clark what's going on. She said, you see, the poor people who took out the small policies signed without knowing it. Larger policies payable to this Tom Bruce. He gladly paid the cost, for when he killed them, he collected on the policy. But now, the money will be paid to their legal heir. That's a lot of exposition, a lot of story drop right in that second to last panel, because then the next panel, the last panel, Clark says, "What a scoop. I wish Superman would help me get a swell story like that sometime." The end. This may have been my least favorite Action Comics story so far. There you have it. Issue 29 of Action Comics from October 1940. What did we learn here? I guess Superman kind of, and Lois, stopped a, like, insurance scam? That was the big takeaway? That's the big excitement? Kind of boring. I mean, there was gunfire. You know, there was, Lois was kidnapped at gunpoint. There was a murder. That was probably my favorite part of the whole thing when he says, "I even took out an insurance policy on you, and here's why." Bam, and kills him. That was easily the highlight of the whole book. Superman smashes through a few buildings. He does take a bullet from a pharmacist, but the pharmacist apparently is off the hook. He's like, "It was an accident." Very convoluted. Just a lot going on. A lot of names. This Tom Bruce guy, this Fullerton guy, they had the insurance, and then it was all because of this political guy, Martin, who was in one panel, then all of a sudden shows up and becomes the main villain. We see this Sergeant Casey, was it? That they're, I wonder if they're going to make him show up more, be kind of like the main policeman that always has to try to stop Superman from doing his vigilante justice. This was... Again, there's some things in it that I enjoyed, but I always get a kick out of just the old-time wording of things like crippled, and then hit skip driver, but seeing the woman just on the ground was kind of funny. I don't know, just like the fact that they ran over an old lady, they killed an old lady. Nothing funny about that, except in an 81-year-old comic book. I feel like this is a short one this week, but... You know, not my favorite. Dare I say, my least favorite, maybe. I mean, last week we had Superman with strong men and clowns and flipping over elephants. And this week he's stopping a mob from breaking into a pharmacy and breaking a safe and evading police multiple times. Lois is an accessory to this and really should be taken in for questioning. But other than that, you know... It was okay. And this episode got out a couple days late. You know, I try to get these episodes out on Mondays. But I'll tell you why. And this will mean nothing to people long in the future listening to this, but I went to a football game Sunday night with my brother to see the Patriots. Went to the Patriots game with my brother and my friend. If you're a football fan, you know that Tom Brady came back to play the Patriots. And we went to the game. Cheered on the Patriots. It didn't work out, but... we got home at 3 a.m. And anytime I go to a game or a concert and I'm going to be yelling and screaming and cheering, the next day, my voice is way down here. And even for like, I think Tuesday, it was that way. And even right now, it's a little lower, a little sultry, more sultry, I should say, because I'm a pretty sultry guy. It's just more of an, I guess you could say, adult male voice, where sometimes my voice is up here. "Hi, guys. How's it going? I love Superman. Yay." So, you know, it's almost back to normal. But I'm enjoying this slightly deeper voice while I can. And that's it. That's a little peel behind the curtain, the Mikey curtain, to see what's why this episode took a couple days later. But it's here. And I'm excited, always excited to talk about Superman, even when the issue, you know, isn't all that great. And I'm going to call this one kind of a meh at best. But that's it. I got nothing else to say. I think we covered it. So I want to thank you guys for listening, as always. Thank you guys for subscribing. Remember, you can always find me on Twitter at Geek Mentality and on Instagram at Reaction Comics. I think that's it. So, super friends, remember one solemn vow. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. Goodbye, super friends. Goodbye. Yeah.
Fans Not Experts.